Welcome to this edition of CBN News Weekend. I'm Mark Martin.
And I'm Charlene Aaron. For some, it's a living nightmare in the classroom. Children are getting math problems so complicated, even parents can't figure them out. What's behind it? Something no one had heard of just a few years ago. It's called Common Core, and the grassroots anger against it has gotten so hot that now it's become an issue in the presidential campaign. Heather Sells brings us the story.
46 states adopted Common Core back in 2010. The thinking, create national standards in English and math that would better prepare students for college and beyond. The decision came easy for states struggling in the recession. That's because the federal government dangled millions in grant money for those that went along.
Most people weren't even aware it was happening. It wasn't until 2 or 3 years later when districts were finally the level of implementation and states said, okay, schools and districts, now you have to implement these things, that the public even became aware of them. And when they became aware, they became angry.
One major frustration, the way Common Core makes even basic math extremely complicated. Parents have been so confused that they couldn't even understand their children's homework. Look at all the steps this teacher uses just to solve 32 minus 12, or the complicated way this teacher figures out 9 plus 6.
We can partner 9 to a number and anchor 10. We can help our students see what 9 plus 6 is. So we're going to decompose our 6.
Ending up with this.
Parents also realized that they had lost control of their local schools, and that's because Common Core standards end up dictating both curriculum and testing.
It was never publicized, and there were certainly never any public hearings or any discussions among parents about the fact that this was going to be a major, you know, a paradigm shift in how almost everything happens in school.
Social media campaigns organized by parents have caught the attention of their schools and lawmakers.
Many parents, rightly so, are up in arms about the policy. And in many cases, they're lashing out against Washington bureaucrats, and they really want to turn it back.
And now, potential presidential candidates on the right are seizing on the momentum.
We need to remove Common Core from every classroom in America.
Jindal and three other governors who once supported Common Core now oppose it. Other likely candidates, Senators Paul, Cruz, and Rubio, also oppose it. The only candidate showing support is former Florida Governor Jeb Bush.
He has been perhaps the primary conservative proponent of Common Core, and lots of other candidates want to pin that on him because this is clearly a major federal intrusion in education.
Even with the added political complaining, it won't be easy to get rid of Common Core. Due to its links with federal funding and No Child Left Behind, states opting out would face financial and regulatory punishment. So some states are going another route, simply refusing to use the Common Core tests.
If you control the test, ultimately you control what your schools teach.
It's the perfect political storm. Angry parents plus social media plus spotlight-seeking candidates. The hope that this contentious debate will actually lead to better education for millions of American school children. Heather Sells, CBN News.
And here to give us an inside look at her findings while reporting on this story is our own Heather Sells. Thanks for joining us, Heather.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it. Now, Common Core has even found its way into the presidential race in Iowa. What are the political implications from all of this?
You know what I think is really interesting is that I think any political candidate right now has to have a position on Common Core. And I'm talking about from the local level all the way to the presidential level. What I was researching today, I found out that Eric Cantor, the House Majority Leader, he was beat by a guy named David Bratt, and David Bratt made opposition to Common Core one of his main themes. So that is, in essence, how he helped to bring down the House Majority Leader. And then you look at these presidential candidates. Bobby Jindal had just a couple moments to speak to people at CPEC. He talked about Obamacare, and he talked about Common Core. So that tells you right there that people are honing in on this as a huge political issue.
Wow. Well, Heather, is there anywhere that you found in your reporting where this has led to any successful environment for education?
You know, that is the goal, of course. I'm not hearing those stories, and maybe they are out there. What's interesting is that the minority community in many ways has really wanted Common Core in the past. There's been a huge concern over what's called education equality, and people are saying, hey, this is a great way to make sure that all schools are teaching the same kinds of things and holding kids to the same standards. So you have seen that backing, but I don't know if you're going to continue to see that backing.
Wow.
Now, as far as how it affects minority students, you spoke with Reverend Samuel Rodriguez about that. Can you share a little bit?
Yes, he is a supporter of the Common Core. There are other people who are minority education advocates who are speaking out in favor of it. So there still is that momentum. I was able to speak with Reverend Rodriguez and Elder Bernice King earlier this week about this whole issue of education equality and how churches can get involved. So let's take a listen.
Let me ask Reverend Rodriguez, you have been meeting with a number of pastors, and what are they telling you about their concerns with the education of minority youth in their churches?
Educational inequality exists in America today, and it behooves us. We have a prophetic mandate. We have a biblical mandate to address any and all issues of injustice. And it's wrong, by the way, Heather. It's wrong for a 12th grader in the inner city to be reading Dora the Explorer while 12th graders in the suburbs are reading Chaucer and Shakespeare. It's wrong. It's morally reprehensible. It's biblically wrong. It's spiritually wrong. These children are all created in the image of God. That's why I do believe, just like the church has addressed issues of segregation and slavery, we have to address issues of educational inequality. That's why we established and launched this week the Faith and Education Coalition.
All right, Elder King, why did you make it a point to meet with pastors, and what do you believe is the role of the church in promoting education for minority youth?
Well, predominantly because of the work that my father did in civil rights, and certainly I believe that education is probably the most important civil rights issue of our time. And I firmly believe that it will take the faith community really getting involved for this issue to move and for us to see substantial change. And so I think the faith community can play a substantial role, in particular, you know, the importance of adopting schools, being present more in the school system with mentors and supporting after school programs.
Wow, interesting that she would say the civil rights issue of our time. That's amazing.
I was really struck that she said that she considers it the most important civil rights issue. But when you think about it, the importance of education in a person's life really can make all the difference.
Huge. What do you think should happen from here?
Well, I think as far as undoing Common Core, it's super complicated. It's one thing for politicians to get up and talk about it. It makes a great talking point. But as far as states getting out of it, really hard, maybe getting out of the testing or maybe trying to make it work. It's a very complicated issue what to do with it. I do think what Bernice King and Samuel Rodriguez were talking about as far as the church getting involved is really exciting. And I think that there's just so many practical ways that churches can offer scholarships, tutor kids, you know, preach it. There are a lot of things that churches can do. So rather than, you know, wring our hands, I think there are some practical, you know, boots on the ground types of things that believers can do.
Excellent.
Yeah, thanks for talking with us, Heather, about Common Core.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it. And don't forget, you can follow Heather at her blog. It's called Newsroom Talk. You can also find her on Twitter at @HandleSellsHeather.
Up next, it's called The School That Works. I'll take you behind the walls of Detroit's Cristo Rey School, where every student works a job.
New York City could soon be bringing prayer back to the classroom. It's all part of Mayor Bill de Blasio's initiative to provide free pre-kindergarten programs. It depends in part on the participation of Jewish, Christian, and Muslim schools. The administration announced that pre-K programs will be allowed to take breaks for non-program activities like prayer. Civil liberties groups are objecting, saying that prayer in a publicly funded classroom violates the Constitution. Some religious schools also are critical of the program. A major Jewish group says the pre-K program is too restrictive.
Well, imagine a big city high school where every senior who graduated in the last 4 years went on to college. Well, that's the impressive track record of the Cristo Rey High School in Detroit. It's a place where kids from low-income families get the chance to succeed in the classroom and beyond. Cristo Rey High School opened to students on the southwest part of Detroit in 2008. In an area plagued by joblessness and poverty, it stands as a symbol of hope and success. The mission here at Detroit Cristo Rey High School is twofold: to serve low-income families and to get seniors into college. It's a goal that has become reality. That's why it's called the school that works.
It's a unique school. For many of our students, they will be the first in their family to go to college. And so it's a big responsibility, but it's also something new for both them and their families to know what it means to be to a college prep school and why we're very demanding academically.
It's one of 28 Catholic high schools across the country that makes up the Cristo Rey Network.
We work really hard with the students. When they're juniors, they spend 50 minutes a day on ACT prep, preparing for the college entrance exam. When they're seniors, we have 50 minutes earmarked in their schedule for college readiness.
Teachers say most of the students haven't received the opportunity for a quality education.
They've been underserved. It's not that they can't learn.
For a lot of them, home life is pretty chaotic too. And a lot of them come here for a sense of not necessarily like physical security, but emotional security, that like having a routine is really important for them.
Tuition runs about $12,000 a year, but families don't have to shoulder the entire cost. Part is covered by a work-study program where students work 5 days a month for companies that help sponsor the school.
Each of them, freshman through senior, work a job, a real job, a professional job. The companies pay us for the work our students do. This year, our students will earn about $1.8 million. They're working at General Motors, Chrysler Corporation, DT Energy, 80 different companies.
One of those sponsors is Ideal Group, a leading parts supplier for GM.
I went to General Motors about this idea of having our kids go there, and today they have almost 40 students that work at General Motors. Now you think about a kid that has 4 years at General Motors working and with executives, working with mentors, finding out what it's like, and put that on your resume. Here they are, they're only out of high school and they're equal to senior interns. It's amazing.
A lot of jobs, like when you're a youth, you go and they don't really give you any responsibilities. At the work study program here, they give you responsibilities.
The school also prides itself on what happens after students graduate. For the fourth year in a row, each Cristo Rey senior will enter a college or university. Paulina Torres plans to study engineering and business at the University of Detroit Mercy. She says Cristo Rey has given her the tools she needs to succeed.
It's prepared me enough that it's a college preparatory school, so I know what's going to be expected next year.
Most here have more than enough choices for their next step.
I haven't decided yet, but I have a lot of choices. I've been accepted into 11 colleges so far. Michigan State, Saginaw Valley, Western Michigan.
Through rigorous academics and real-world experience, Cristo Rey students are ready to excel academically and in life.
For some of them, it might be like the first time that they really feel accomplished, the first time they really feel, you know what, I really did something with my time and with my life here. And I'm really proud of myself, and I know that this is just the first step.
We already hear the younger students, they know that they have a tradition to maintain.
And what an amazing school, the students, the staff. And what's so really, really wonderful is the teachers tell me when the kids get those acceptance letters, they come to school and there's a lot of emotion on both sides, the kids and the teachers are amazingly overwhelmed by it.
Saw that sign there at the end of the piece that said, the school that works.
And that's their motto.
I understand they help students after graduation as well. Explain that.
It's amazing. They don't just let the kids go on their own to college. They monitor them. And if they find that once they're in college, they're needing some help, they get them the tools they need to be successful in college. So it's not just we're helping you and then you get to college and we don't help you. No, we're helping you to be successful the entire time.
Like that one student said, it was a college prep school.
Exactly.
And she feels prepared.
Absolutely amazing.
Yeah, you got to talk to a lot of wonderful people there.
Parents are amazed, the kids, the whole community supports this school. I mean, you saw GM is involved. There are banks and credit unions. There are so many people who really want to see these kids go on to do successful things.
All right, great amazing story, yeah. Well, coming up,
I came from nothing and now I can learn about anything. I also learned how to dream.
CBN is changing the lives of students and young people in Indonesia. We'll show you how.
Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you.
That's our CBN Good News verse of the week from Matthew 7:7.
At the heart of learning is the willingness to ask God to teach us.
That's right. We just need to seek Him and He will answer us. It might not always be the way we are expecting.
That's right. But His promises endure and His wisdom is without end, so we know that we can trust Him. Well, poor and unschooled children in Indonesia are receiving a free education thanks to CBN. Not only are the kids learning to read and write, but they're also being taught godly values. CBN's Asia correspondent Lucille Talusan brings us more.
Rini was in eighth grade when she stopped going to school. Her parents did not have the money to pay for her education. Other children residing in this poor community near Jakarta had a similar experience. Unschooled, they lived without purpose. CBN social workers in Indonesia responded by establishing a school that gives free education to children like Rini and her friends.
At first, I was not really interested in studying. I was lazy and rebellious. But my father ordered me to go back to school. And now, I like coming to this school because aside from the regular subjects, I enjoy learning different skills.
Here, the students are taught how to make the design on the batik, which is the material used to make Indonesian traditional clothes. And this is a skill taught to the students to empower them and to help them earn a living.
Kindergarten students learned values by watching Superbook. Bobby Gafur is the head of the CBN school.
95% are Muslim students. Every race, every ethnic, and every religion, they can come to our school. The way we reconcile about the religion, we just teach them about the Christian values.
Parents like Maria are happy with their children's development.
My son's behavior has improved. He can now be friends with everybody. He tells me, there's this good guy, Isa Al-Masih. He can heal. He can make people see.
Maria was inspired by her son's words. Though a Muslim, she asked the school staff to pray that the lump in her breast would disappear.
I am very happy that they can pray for my healing. Prayer is an expression of love. Thank you for your help and encouragement.
The school is helping to transform the hearts and minds of the students.
I am very satisfied with how they are helping my daughter. Before, she didn't help me, but now her behavior is changed. I am very happy that she is able to continue her studies because all her older siblings didn't even reach high school.
I came from nothing and now I can learn about anything. I also learned how to dream to become a doctor someday. Thank you too for teaching me about Jesus because right now I know Him well.
And with the right foundation, the future of these young people now looks very promising. Lucille Talusan, CBN News, Jakarta.
And thank you, Lucille, for bringing us that story. It's interesting to see how important education is all over the world.
All over the world, indeed. It really does open up a lot of opportunities and provide hope to young people finding their way.
Let's take a moment, and we're going to pray for education here and overseas.
Amen.
How about I'll pick up and I'll dial and you hang up?
Amen. Sounds good to
me. Okay. Father God, we just lift up education to you, God, here in the U.S. and overseas. We pray that you would bless our education efforts. God, we pray that people in third world countries and then people in other countries would receive the education that they need. We pray that you would raise up teachers. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would anoint them to do what you have called them to do. We just pray for a breakthrough in the education system here in the U.S. and around the world, God. I pray that the kids are taught what they are supposed to be taught. And we pray that prayer is allowed in school as well.
And we pray that, Lord, education will be used to glorify Jesus Christ because it's all about you and it's all said and done, Lord, that children all over the world and educators would acknowledge you in all of their ways. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Up next, CBN is bringing a unique kind of education to young people and single mothers in El Salvador. We'll be right back. Operation Blessing is helping to end poverty in communities in El Salvador through vocational training. Teams have developed programs for vulnerable communities, especially for single moms and young people lacking proper education. They're teaching them how to make handmade hammocks. It's the first step toward helping them establish their very own small businesses and provide an income to rise out of poverty. Operation Blessing will continue to support these business initiatives with training in marketing and savings. And you can find out more about Operation Blessing by going to their website at ob.org.
Another wonderful example of good, solid education.
That's what the church is supposed to be doing, out in the community, making a difference.
That's right. Amen. That's right. Well, that's all for this hour of CBN News Weekend.
Remember, you can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com and stay up to date with CBN News through Facebook and Twitter.
Hope you'll join us next time and have a wonderful weekend.
God bless.